Well, a very good morning to you all, and it's a real pleasure to be here this morning with all of you who are starting a new journey of life outside of school and into somewhat more flexi space. I must also start by saying that introducers oftentimes to overstate the case. So don't get overwhelmed. I always sort of say that it's better to say less and get more rather than say more and get less. So I think one should stay a little humble. Well, first of all, I'm sort of delighted to be here, and let me on behalf of sort of NIIT University, and you as we are called, welcome you all to the university on behalf of the board. And say how delighted we are that you are with us. I hope that your years at NU will be rewarding in many, many ways. I hope that you will certainly gain knowledge of the arena that you want to gain knowledge in, engineering in this particular case. But I also hope that your knowledge actually extends far beyond engineering. In the space of engineering and the associated subjects, you better be good if you want to be competing in the world outside. So that's a space that you must be good at because you want to be successful people in life beyond the university. So being good in engineering is almost like a base given. It's the base minimum. The question is that if you are going to compete with colleagues from and friends and associates and competitors from outside the world of engineering who are equally good as you are, the question that you would have to ask yourselves is, what therefore will be the differentiator? How will I be different? Given the fact that I'm as good as an engineer, I've got those rather sort of astronomical kind of figures of percentages that you all get these days, 98s and 95s, and you've got no percentages. In my time, incidentally, I stood 6th in the university in economics, and I had 59% marks. 6th in the university, but 59%. There were only two people who got plus of 60% marks in my time. But these days, of course, if I said 60%, my grandchildren sort of laugh at me and say, Nana, you're obviously not there. 60%, goodness me. So anyway, I hope that therefore your time here will actually not only deliver you exceptional engineering experiences, but hopefully will give you some value additions beyond engineering. And those value additions, let me assure you, each one of you, remember this. Good engineering, you will be competing with everybody else from whichever institution they come from, because they will also be equally good engineers. How will potential employers, or many of you who will be entrepreneurs, how will you succeed in the competitive world will be how much more you do with yourselves during these years. So may I first of all urge you that do use the experience of NU, not simply to do good in your area, specific area of concern, but also in some other areas. And in those some other areas, one subset is what I propose to be sharing some thoughts with you this morning. Now, just to get a sense, incidentally, of all of you, I'm going to ask you a few questions. And if you put up your hands, one over this next 1 hour, please be interactive. Stop me, put up your hand, and after I finish my comment, in the sense of whatever it is that I'm wanting to say, I will make sure that we interact. So keep it interactive. You know, I don't want this to be a session which is only one way. So feel free to put up your hand if you think that there's something that you have to say, contribute, or ask about. So I'm going to ask you a few questions. Tell me how many of you think of yourselves as coming from the eastern part of the country? East. Put up your hands. Okay. We will take about 25. From the western part of the country, a little more, okay? On the northern part of the country? Yeah, so that's about 50%. And the southern part of the country? Wow. Wow. Clear majority. Clear majority. Wonderful. So, as you can see, all of you also incidentally, that you guys represent a fairly good cohort of young people who incidentally are representative of this country. You come from all parts of the country. Now, a few more questions that will help me understand where you all are coming from. How many, and put up your hands up, how many of you believe that same-sex marriage is acceptable? Put up your hands. So it appears to me about 60% believe that same-sex marriage is okay. Good. How many of you believe that India should move much more towards being a Hindu nation as against being a solidly secular one? Put up your hands who believe that it should do more towards Hindu nation. So some of you guys are in a sheer minority, if I might mention. That's okay. Hold your view, because I think it's important that we have all views. But it appears that 90% of you do seriously believe in the secular traditions of this country, and in some ways. How many of you believe, put up your hands, that diversity is a bad idea? Fantastic. Nobody believes that. And that, incidentally, is one of your and our collective best heritage, is the fact that we are a wonderfully, wonderfully diverse nation. So that's terrific. So certainly it's given me an idea of you all, but I suspect each one of you also has a sense of the kind of people you are going to spend the next 4 years with. Right? And I think that's important. That's important. And so if I were to sort of say, you are a multicultural, multi-geographic, liberal, forward-looking young people. If I were asked after this talk that you spoke to a cohort of students, how would you define them? That's how would I define them. Do you all agree? Put up your hands. Do you all agree that you are multicultural, multi-ethnic, multi-geographic, diverse-loving young people? Lovely. Good. None of the senior faculty members put up their hands. But it's unfair because I didn't ask them the question. So this is good. This is very representative, and I'm actually rather pleased as a member of the board that we have such like students at our university. So thank you very much for doing that. Now I'm going to spend a little time today, and I'm sure that as you go through your initiations at the campus, that there will be many people who will come and speak to you and share with you, you know, what some of our objectives are and how as a university we propose to sort of make that experience available to you. Today, I'm going to spend a little time on talking to you about perspectives. And how it is important for all of us to recognize that having different perspectives is in fact a unique, if not a critical, quality of the modern human being. If we do not have this quality of able to appreciate, recognize, understand perspectives, we're not likely to be successful future citizens. And does that sort of resonate with you? Are you in agreement, general agreement with that idea?
Yes.
Huh? So each one of you would agree that if you don't have multiple perspectives, that you are not likely to be as successful as many of you would want to be. Now, in that arena of perspectives, so what is a perspective? What is a perspective? A perspective is a point of view about a phenomenon. The phenomenon can be a physical one, or a phenomenon can be a non-physical one, right? And And that phenomenon, when you observe that phenomenon as human beings, you observe a phenomenon and you develop a perspective on that phenomenon. So if the phenomenon is that there have been some fellows who have jumped across the border and are shooting at us, each one of us has a perspective about how we give meaning to that. We are either angry, or we are supportive, or we don't agree, or we develop a perspective, correct? And you would all have been part of settings in schools and at home and in, amongst friends where somebody in a group says something and then other people come up with different points of view. So a different point of view, in fact, is representative of the idea that there are different perspectives. And I think for young people, it's absolutely crucial that you all agree. And I'll give you a very good example of this. Many years ago, there was an institution in London. It's called the Speaker's Corner in Hyde Park. Have you all heard about the Speaker's Corner in Hyde Park? Who has? Nobody has. Before the advent of television, and you could hear, nowadays you can hear everybody who's got a point of view on television, but before that, in the biggest park of London, there was a corner, which was called the Speaker's Corner. And in the Speaker's Corner, you could put yourself a little box, stand on it, and speak on anything that you wanted to. And you could express any point of view that you wanted to. And if you were in the Speaker's Corner, by convention, not by law, but by convention, you were protected. In other words, no matter how absurd your point of view was, you were protected. You could even say nasty things about the Queen. And that's a very difficult thing to do in the UK. Okay? But you could say, in that corner, you were protected. So as a young student, when I used to visit the UK, I always spent, almost every Sunday, spending a little point of my time. And I want to give you an example of that. It's about perspectives. So at that time, the apartheid movement was very big. This is, now we are talking the late 60s, early 70s. Apartheid movement, the black movement, was very big. South Africa still had not got independence. Many of the black communities of Africa were still under colonial rule. And so there was a big issue in the Western world about what to do with the future of the black movements, and many of them were seeking independence. So one day at the Speaker's Corner, and I used to regularly hear this gentleman, a black individual, you cannot think of a more eloquent person, at least I at that time couldn't think of a more eloquent person. And he was really powerfully attacking the white establishment about not allowing freedom and to the black communities of South Africa. Of Africa, actually. Really hard-hitting stuff. Powerful arguments. Really, really, really interesting and powerful arguments. It was so powerful that one person in the audience, and he had an audience bigger than this, incidentally, that evening, and he obviously got one person in the audience very riled. So this gentleman, incidentally, and nowadays this may not be as unparliamentary as it sounded then. But I will share with you, and you can sort of, if I may say, pardon my French, is that this gentleman shouted, he was so angry at this black speaker, that he shouted by saying, "Shut up, you bastard." And in the 70s, you didn't use such terminology in public. And there was a sort of a pin drop silence in the audience for a while. This black speaker turned around and in the most eloquent and subdued English, he responds, "Sir," and this is a quote. He says, "Sir, from the part of the world where I come from, the institution of marriage doesn't exist. Therefore, sir, by definition, I cannot be a bastard. And sir, from the part of the world where you come from, it is a distinct possibility that you are one." about two very different perspectives. Very different perspectives. The whole institution of marriage is fundamental to vast portions of the world. And all of us have grown up in believing on about its sanctity. It's challenged because it didn't exist in some parts of the world. So who is right and who is wrong? Who is right and who is wrong? Depending upon the context. It is right in one place and not right in another. And so I think the question of saying, who is the better person? The person who understands both perspectives. He is the better person. He knows. So there's a wonderful example which was sort of fished out of back in the Victorian age. The Victorian shoe companies decided to send their marketing head to Africa and said, well, you know, go out and check, the market is opening up, Africa is going to be growing, so tell us about what is the potential for shoes in Africa. So this gentleman, head of marketing, went to Africa and did his market survey and responded by a one-liner which said, nobody in Africa wears shoes, no potential, story over. And if nobody wears shoes, obviously maybe the board and others of those respective companies thought that there's no potential. Bata sent their representative to Africa. And he did his survey and he said, nobody in Africa wears shoes, huge potential. And Bata won the day. You know, you can go anywhere in Africa and buy a Bata shoe. Different perspectives. Depending upon where you came from. So this question of looking at different perspectives. Now, in a world which was insular, take ourselves 150 years back. We had largely village India, 600,000 villages. Village India. Nobody traveled beyond too many distances. Few people did. You could be very insular in your approach, and whatever was right or wrong was in the context of your setting. But as the world has changed, it's now rather become a single world. And yet, incidentally, and I'll give you another example before I show you one little clip of that. Now the world, each one of us incidentally, on a regular basis, faces multiple perspectives, some of which you are in agreement, some about which you don't care, and some about which you are definitely against. So like it or not, as an individual, you will be compelled to be able to develop coping mechanisms to deal with all those three options. I agree, I don't care, I disagree. All those three kinds of people might be sitting across you in conference rooms, in your colleagues as company officials, or as family members. Each one of us these days has got family members who are married outside the community, who are married internationally. So that's the reality. And we are all required to sort of cope with that. So you will be required to cope with this wonderfully new set of perspectives that, like it or not, we will. Now, their importance, well, I will spend a little time sharing with you about the theory behind perspectives. What's the theory? Which might explain and therefore help some of you who might want to delve a little more deeper in the theory later on that you might wish to think about. But before that, let me give you a little clip which I want you to see. And it's about all of us, I trust, have seen the normal globe of the world. Yes? The planet? You've all seen the globe? We've seen, do you mentally have a sense of where Europe is on the globe? Everybody?
Yes.
I hope so. No? Okay. And everybody has a sense of where Africa is?
Yes.
On the globe? And we have a sense of the equator?
Yes.
And we have a sense of what is north and what is south? Right? Okay. Now, you have this sense, you have a perspective about the globe. Right? Now, I'm going to put this clip up. And then we will have a little chat before I say a few more things. Can we have that clip, please? You might want to see it.
Aggressively support legislation that would make it mandatory for every public school in America to teach geography using the Peters projection map instead of the traditional Mercator.
Give me $200 and it's done.
Really?
No. Why are we changing maps?
Because, CJ, the Mercator projection has fostered European imperialist attitudes for centuries and created an ethnic bias against the Third World.
Really?
The German cartographer, Mercator, originally designed this map in 1569 as a navigational tool for European sailors.
The map enlarges areas at the poles to create straight lines of constant bearing or geographic direction.
So it makes it easier to cross an ocean.
But yeah. It distorts the relative size of nations and continents.
Are you saying the map is wrong?
Oh dear, yes. Now look at Greenland.
Okay.
Now look at Africa.
Okay.
The two land masses appear to be roughly the same size.
Yes.
It would blow your mind if I told you that Africa is, in reality, 14 times larger.
Yes. Here we have Europe drawn considerably larger than South America. When it's 6.9 million square miles, South America is almost double the size of Europe's 3.8 million.
Alaska appears three times as large as Mexico, when Mexico is larger by 0.1 million square miles.
Germany appears in the middle of the map and is in the northernmost quarter of the Earth.
Wait. Relative size is one thing, but you're telling me that Germany isn't where we think it is?
Nothing's where you think it is.
Where is it?
I'm glad you asked. The Peters projection.
It has fidelity of axis.
Fidelity of position.
East-west lines are parallel and intersect north-south axes at right angles.
What the hell is that?
It's where you've been living this whole time. Should we continue? So, you're probably wondering what all of this has to do with social equality.
No, I'm wondering where France really is.
Guys, we want to thank you very much for coming in.
Hang on, we're going to finish this.
Okay.
What do maps have to do with social equality, you ask?
She asked.
Salvatore Natoli of the National Council for Social Studies argues, in our society, we unconsciously equate size with importance and even power.
I'm gonna check in on Tommy.
Go.
These guys find Brigadoon on that map, you'll call me, right?
Probably not.
Okay.
When third world countries are misrepresented, they're likely to be valued less. When Mercator maps exaggerate the importance of Western civilization, when the top of the map is given the northern hemisphere, and the bottom is given the southern, then people will tend to adopt top and bottom attitudes.
But wait, how? Where else could you put the northern hemisphere but on the top?
On the bottom.
How?
Like this?
Yes, you can't do that.
Why not?
Because it's freaking me out.
Hi, I'm sorry.
Oh.
Sorry to be late.
No problem.
I'm CJ Craig.
Of course you are. I'm Dr. John Fowler. I'm Dr. Cynthia Sales, and
okay, so here you are. Does that resonate? Does that make sense? So to how many of you did it make sense? Not too many. And therefore maybe it's a good time to take a few minutes trying to understand what was said. What was said was that the planet was represented by topographers in a particular way as determined by those who were the creators of maps in the beginning, which was the northern, western European world. Whenever you look at a sheet of paper, when you first look at, because you think the most important thing might be said there, when you look at the top. We all say that, did you get the number one position? The number one position is supposed to be at the top. We are all sort of culturally, sort of indoctrinated to believe that that what is on the top is better than that what is at the bottom. So the map as it was conceived, one represents Europe much bigger than it is as compared to the rest of the land masses, particularly the ones in the third world. And you could well have developed a map where all the so-called southern parts of the world could actually have been placed on the northern part of the world, on the map. Because as you know, in space, there is no such thing as up or down. Right? So having been South Africa, that was the center of the world, let's say, in terms of evolution, do you think the South Africans would have developed the map of the world in the same way the Europeans did? No? Right? So, here you have pointedly different perspectives about how a map of the planet can be presented. Pointedly different. If India was the center of civilization, which it was, except that we didn't spend too much time on topography, and didn't have reason too much to go outside and look what was in the rest of the world, everybody seemed to come to us, and we were quite happy with that. But if we had prepared the map, we would have probably made India the center of the map, and everything else, wherever else. Right? Not too understanding. But we thought that the map that we were all used to was the only real, true map. Is that fair?
Yes.
All of us? As we spoke before we saw the video. And I think it sort of points out to the importance of recognizing that you can take the planet, but you can view it in multiple different ways. And you as students, incidentally, through your lifetimes, I can guarantee you this, that the planet actually will be viewed from very different ways. It will be viewed from very different ways. You will see it from a distance much, much more intricately than we see it today. Some of you might even be on terra firma moon and see the planet from there. And that's the reality. But we will see it in very different ways. Now, if you all walk into your futures thinking that the only way to look at the planet is the way that you've already looked at it, I suspect you will be at a disadvantage to many others who will recognize that there are multiple ways of looking at the planet. So, I would say it's important that you get to knowing that there are sort of different realities. Now, you might ask the question, and some of this has already sort of come up, you might ask the question, so what relevance is all this to me? An IIT university, I'm going to be tech engineering, so what is this for me? How is it important? And I go back to a point that I made to you a little earlier. Being good in engineering is a given. If you're not good in engineering, guys, forget it. You know, just forget it. You just have to be good at engineering. The question is that between two good engineering students, the person sitting on the other side of the table who's going to be interviewing you or is going to be thinking of making an associate in a business enterprise is going to say, engineering, this guy knows or this girl knows. But you know, they come up with a whole bunch of other terrific competencies. And one such competency that we want the NU student to have is this ability to understand that the world is actually rather complex. That what is real is may not necessarily be real. And in this sort of arena, might I suggest that you, if you ever get the opportunity, the science is called phenomenology. Write it down. Write down phenomenology. Phenomenology. For those of you who might be interested to understand and get a conceptual foundation in this whole question of multiple perspectives, getting a reasonable appreciation of this science would be useful to you. Would be useful to you. Now, what is phenomenology? I'm simplifying or oversimplifying, but just to give you a sense. If I put a chair on this table, on this platform here, if I put a chair, and I point to the chair, and I ask you all, what is this object? Is it fair to think that almost 100% of you will say it's a chair? Is it fair? Yeah, I think it's fair that most of you will say it's a chair. Any other people who would think it's otherwise? Put up your hands. Be daring. No, okay. Everybody thinks it's a chair. That was a chair here. So let me give you another example. Just prior to the beginning of the First World War, there was a ship that was traveling from the UK to the US, to Australia. And it was carrying in it a full shipload of, have you heard of the company called Shanks? It's a sanitary ware company. They make sanitary equipment. It used to be, I don't think it's that popular these days. But the Shanks company had a whole shipload of, if I may use again the word, ship parts that they were carrying from the UK to Australia. Like somebody had ordered a shipload of ship parts. And they were traveling, and then the war breaks out. So the captain of the ship is instructed that will you please offload your cargo wherever you are and report back to Singapore for war duty because your ship is being requisitioned. So this poor captain goes to the nearest Micronesian island and offloads on this island the whole shipload of ship parts. And goes away to do his duty. 50 years later, a bunch of anthropologists happen to arrive on this island. And they find the whole place. The whole place is full of these Shanks ship parts. And it is these people's home, it is in, lying in the chief's anchor room, it is lying in parks, it is lying in public places, all these Shanks ship parts all over the place. They recorded 111 different uses that were put to that object called the ship part. Not one of them was the ship part. So this object which we just spoke about, the chair, this object which in any part of the Western world, if we had looked at it, or some of us would have looked at it, we said, ship part. But there was nothing in the object that said what it is. It is with the eyes with which you see it. All of us collectively agree that an object that looks like this thing that I put here, which is the chair, is a chair because we all agree, in a subjective sense, that this object is a chair. But nothing in the object itself tells us what it is. There's nothing inherent in that configuration of that piece of furniture which suggests that it's a chair. Because we all agree that if it can be used as a chair, we call it a chair. So just like the ship part, if it was in the Western world or if it was in Australia, everybody would have said ship part. But when people had never seen this, they imbued the phenomena of this object, they gave it new meaning, different meanings. Incidentally, one of the uses was that it was the currency of that Micronesian island. Because it was made of ceramic, it didn't, the elements didn't do any damage to it, it sort of retained its glamour, and it lied in different places, but the village knew that one, though it's lying in my house, actually belongs to me. So the whole village knew that, but it became a medium of exchange, it became money. Different perspective. Same object, same phenomena, means one thing. And why does it mean anything? It is because we all come with certain lenses that we see reality with. And critical to the idea of lenses is context. And that I want to spend a little time on explaining. What is real, what is right, or what is wrong is actually very, very contextual. Would you, any of you, be surprised if you saw a young lady wearing a bikini on the sands of the beaches of Goa? Would you all be surprised? Would any of you, other than all the young men who might think her attractive, but other than that, would you be surprised to see somebody in a bikini on the beaches of Goa? Not really, right? Now, if on the other hand, the same young lady walked into a boardroom with a bikini, do you think we would be surprised as board members? Maybe some of you won't be when you are board members. But would you be surprised as board members? Yeah, it's fair to say. Now, the interesting thing is that actually the element of concern here, or that what we're observing, is a piece of wear, a two-unit piece of wear. Means one thing in the setting of a beach, means quite another in the setting of a boardroom. The piece of clothing is the same. No change. Same phenomenon. Let me give you another example. You all heard of the mutiny of 1857? Yes? Come on, guys. 1857? Right. How did history books written by the British and Westerners, how did they define the 1857 occurrence? What did they call it? Sorry? What did they call that event of 1857, the British and the history books? They called it the mutiny of 1857. The mutiny. Now, if you have a mutinous group of people, if they are mutinous, what is the normal consequence? The normal consequence is you are likely to be charged and the courts are likely to give you a variety of sentences, the leaders of which might actually be hung. Right? I mean, if it's a mutiny. That's what the British defined it as a mutiny. Many Indians, incidentally, define that as India's first war of independence. And what do you do with all those who sacrifice their lives for independence? You give them Bharat Ratnas. You put them on pedestals. You applaud them. That's what you do with people who are involved with movements of independence. Same event. Two dramatically contradictory conclusions, depending upon whose eyes and whose lenses were being applied to see and observe that phenomenon. Is that fair? Right? Reasonable. So again, this question of perspectives is important. Now, what we want to do as one of our objectives of having you all study at NU. And we have a particular initiative called TALF. Have you all heard of TALF?
Yes, sir.
You've heard of TALF. And it's called the Asian Lenses Forum. About 3-4 years ago, we started this initiative. And the objective of this initiative is, you guys represent South Asia. Like it or not, whether the world likes it or not, you all are going to impact the world. Whether the world likes it or not, you will impact. Okay? Now, if you are going to impact the world, I think it's important that you, one, have the competency of recognizing different perspectives, and two, you have a very good and strong foundation of your own heritage and your own background. If in the 60s, when I was a student of your kind, If in the 60s somebody said to me that, you know, India is going to put a probe in the orbit of Mars, most of us would have laughed. The fellow who would have said that proposition would have been thought of being a little bit of an idiot because he doesn't sort of know the real world. But today, when that is said, we all accept it as a given. Is that right? Do you guys all think that we can now land somebody on Mars? What's your sense, everybody? Can we land somebody on Mars?
Yes, sir.
We can? Yeah. And that's exactly the point. The reason why you are saying that is because you know we've done it. We sent a probe. We sent the most cost-effective probe into the orbit of Mars. And we've done many other things. In a talk that I was giving at the Judge School of Business at Cambridge University a few years ago, I made a comment that, do you know that India today manages the world? So everybody, in the question answer session, this one young lady got up and said, how can you make this ridiculous claim that India manages the world? I said, no, I have a reasonable justification for it. I said, if you take the five big, at that time there were the five big consultancy firms, if you take the five big consultancy firms, 50% of their principal partners are either Indian or of Indian origin. These five consultancy firms, global firms, incidentally, advise governments, advise corporates, advise not-for-profits, advise communities, advise individuals. They actually advise everybody. In many instances, partner in the management. So who do you think is managing the world? If 50% of these are of Indian origin or Indian. Now that's a big change from my era. If in my era somebody said that a global corporation can have an Indian as its CEO, again you would be laughed at. Today that is blasé. Everyone believes that you all will do things like that. So one, I would urge that wherever you are and wherever you are in the future, in whatever be the nature of challenge or initiative that you are associated with, it could be an industrial enterprise, it could be a social enterprise, you could be running your own business, you could have to deal with family. Do you all think democracy is a good idea, incidentally?
Yes, sir.
Democracy?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, good idea? Good idea, right?
Yes, sir.
Would you stand up and give up your lives for democracy? Somebody, I think, should. No? Okay. Anyway, that maybe is asking too much. But you all believe it, right? When you go home, is your home a democratic space? Or does dad or mom pull the strings? In most cases, dad or mom pull the strings, right? So you will like the idea of democracy, you're willing to possibly go a great distance to fight it, but in the context of your home, you think you're okay to accept a very patriarchal system, very dominated by the patriarch, whether the patriarch is the male member of the family or the, as many would say, the mother-in-law. So the context is important. So in your workspaces, in your enterprises for the future, in your settings, one question always ask yourself, what's unique in terms of context of this situation? Context. I'll give you an example again, why context is important. You've all heard of the cooperative movement?
Yes.
The big success of Amul and the whole raising of milk production in this country was by the cooperative movement in Gujarat. You all heard of it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now, the same set of things that were done under the cooperative movement in Gujarat, which was an astounding success, they took the same set of initiatives and put them up in Punjab. Failed miserably. The cooperative movement succeeds in Gujarat, fails in Punjab. But let's say now, you are actually the managing director of Amul, or you're the managing director of some other initiative. Do you think that if you are the managing director and you're looking at your Gujarat program, that you would say, I need to look at what is unique about Gujarat, and I need to look at what is unique in contextual terms about Punjab or West Bengal or Tamil Nadu or Andhra, whatever it might be? You would look at what is unique, right? So what is it that you're looking at? You're looking at the context of that when you want to take up an initiative. That's what you want to do. So if you want to succeed in whatever it is that you want to do, whatever it is that you want to do, incidentally, five of you, any of you can get together and you might decide to do something together, and if you take that same something to your parents may not think that it's a good idea. Right? Is that a likelihood, guys? Is that a likelihood? As for instance, all of you, 65% of you who said that same-sex marriage is a good idea or is an acceptable idea, you think if you went to your parents, that some of you were so inclined, and you went to your parents and said, you know, I'm supposed to get married to this young lady or young man, do you think that your parents would have the same view as you? Tell me how many of your parents you think will have the same view as you? So we had a 65% who themselves believed it was okay, but we have about 10% whose parents would also agree. So you have a little challenge when you deal with the idea, should you be, as I said, in that situation, as to how you would take it up, because your parents are likely to take it up, have a very different view. Right? So context is important. Now many of us, incidentally, many of us are seduced by the idea of scale, right? In the not-for-profit sector, one of the things that we say to ourselves is, it's a damn good idea, it succeeded, how can we take it to scale? Marketeers know it all the time. So Mr. McDonald's came to India a few years ago and decided that they were going to launch their very famous product called the hamburger in India. Do you all know what happened to them in the early days?
Yes, sir.
What happened?
Sir, the beef, that there was a whole lot of issue upon...
Loudly.
Sir, there was a whole lot of issue upon eating beef in India. People were getting killed, and also hamburger would not be allowed in India. So that is what...
Correct. So they had a few of their stores burnt down, and even though McDonald's was told in advance that it may not succeed in India, they thought, we have a world-class product. It sells around the world. How can it be that it will not sell in India? So what they did was, of course, after a little bit of heartburn and losing a few elements of their profits, they realized that actually they could still continue to call it a hamburger, but it's a vegetarian hamburger. They contextualized their product. They made it relevant to India. They didn't lose the brand of hamburger, but they contextualized and said, actually it's a vegetarian hamburger. Now, if Mr. Manager had been intelligent and had been recognized that this is the kind of thing that you need to do, you need to understand context, he would have not made this mistake. So context is critically important, particularly in tomorrow's world and in today's world. So as students of NU, if we can, through the TALC initiative, expose you to initiatives and ideas that help you better understand that, look, there are different perspectives in the world. How many of you, incidentally, okay, let me do a little bit of an experiment. I'm going to use one word. Please, for those who might take a little ill to it, don't take ill to it. I mean no harm to anybody. But I'm going to ask you to give me your first reaction to a word. And I can tell you this, that I did the same thing with a group of people who were part of what is called the Indo-UK Roundtable. It is a group of 15 people appointed by the respective two prime ministers. I happen to be a member of the roundtable. And it's a group of 15 people on either side. Our vice president, for instance, Mr. Hamid Ansari, was the co-chair from the India side. And some of you might have heard of Chris Patton, who is the chair of BBC and now is the chancellor of Oxford University. He was the co-chair, is the co-chair from the UK side. We had the best minds, vice chancellors of universities, CEOs, chairmen of corporations, some of the best minds who are part of this Indo-UK roundtable. We engage on matters and then we meet once in 6 months, and we are not obliged to uphold the views of our respective governments. So it's a free flowing. And we send suggestions to the two respective prime ministers. Now it's up to the prime ministers to take them up or not take them up, but that's what we do. Now in that setting, I use the same, and I'm going to use it with you all also. I'm going to use one word, okay, one word. And I want you to tell me the first thought that comes to your mind when I use the word. Okay? You got it? Got it?
Yes, sir.
I'm going to say one word. Be honest now. And I'm in advance saying nobody should take umbrage to this. It's not meant to be damaging in any way. So I'm going to take one word, and then I want you all, and then we'll pick up a few of you who will tell me what came to your minds. Okay? So, here goes. The one word, very quickly, is Islam.
What?
Stop. Everybody should have that. So, you have one response in your mind? Right? Now, can we have a few views from this side? Give me a view. Give me a view.
A religion.
The world having a misconception about it.
Sorry?
The world having a misconception about it.
The world having a misconception about it. Okay.
Humans.
Sorry?
Humans.
Human?
Sir, human beings.
Love.
Human beings.
Human needs.
Me beings.
Human beings.
Human beings. Human beings. Yeah. Sorry? Totally?
Sufi music.
I can say it loudly, I can't hear you guys.
Sufi music.
Sufi music, wonderful, yeah. Who else? Yes? Loudly, yes?
Syria civil war.
Wonderful. Media. Okay, some more from this side.
A team.
Okay. Part of us.
Kind of community.
Okay. Now I have to say to you that I am completely impressed with you guys. Completely impressed with you guys. Not only am I impressed with you guys, I'm so pleased that you are students of NIIT. Because the responses that you have given actually speak the truth. In every single one of the comments that you've made, that is the truth. Human beings, community, Sufi music. Wonderful, wonderful set of comments. Now, let me tell you what happened in that setting. It was also a setting which was for some rather unfortunate incidences. Do you know that in a group of 30, there was not one good comment about reacting to roles? So they said gun toting, extremists, violence. They had all those kind of reactions. Your reactions are absolutely stunning. And I promise you that at the next meeting, if I'm still a member of that community, I shall mention to them that this is the response that we got from young people in India on that same comment from NU students. So I actually want to give you guys a hand. So I am really pleased that your perception about what is a rather difficult idea in the world today, and I am pleased that you have a perspective of the kind that represents your one-liner comment. You represent a perspective. When people say Islam, lots of people come with their absolutely foolishly wrong conclusions. You guys have come up with the absolutely right one. We are talking about a faith. We are talking about human beings. We are talking about the most wonderful. Incidentally, to this group of people, when I was very upset, and just as much as I've said all those things that I've applauded you for, I was pretty harsh in my comments to my colleagues at that time, that how terrible it is that we have this group. And then I told them, and some of you might wish to spend some time on them, and I explained to them that, you know, what is the most powerful human emotion? What's the most powerful human emotion? Sorry?
Love.
Sorry? Willingness? Willingness.
Patriotism.
Okay. Anyway, yeah, write that, write that.
Hatred.
Sorry?
Hatred.
Hatred. Powerful emotion, yes.
Smile.
Sorry?
Smile.
Might.
Smile.
Mind. So human emotion, and I tend to agree with the first one, which is love. Okay? So I think one of the most powerful human emotions is love. Right? And I said to them that we're all great exponents of the English language. You know, we all speak it rather well. We know it. It's the language of the world. This very powerful language called English is so poor in defining the most powerful human emotion called love. It has only one word for the love between mother and child, between the love between two friends, between the love between two lovers, between the love between two friends. Only one word. How pathetically inadequate that was. I said Urdu. For those of some of you who enjoy Urdu, it has 17 different dispositions around that idea. That's how rich it is. And where did it go? Where the two great faiths met. Urdu as a language, where the Islamic world met the so-called Hindu world, and this area of northwestern India, where Urdu grew as a language, produced this beauty. And therefore, I think some of the comments that you made were absolutely spot on in terms of saying, that's the brilliance. That's the brilliance. So context is important. I'll give you one more personal example. Many years ago, I was in the US studying as a graduate student, and I also happened to be then the president of my student body, which in those days was quite a thing in the Bay Area. And I had a friend who was, it was also, you would have all heard about the hippie movement. The hippie movement of the late 60s and the early 70s, flower power and the women's rights movement and all that was all coalescing at that time. Anyway, I had a friend who was the son of a very, very eminent business and professional family who used to live in Santa Ana in Southern California. And very rich parents, and he was a friend of mine, and he was caught up in this hippie movement. So he had grown long hair and generally had jeans that were not very clean, he wore. So he was a very good representative of today's youth. Anyway, so he one day came barging into my flat, all very upset, swearing all kinds of obscenities, and I'm not gonna use them, but swearing all kinds of obscenities at his father. I said, what's happened to him? He said, you know, this guy, all the expletives. He says, you know, he's written me a letter. And in the letter he has said that if you don't cut your hair and clean yourself up, I'm going to disown you. What the hell does this guy mean? Da, 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 da. And I told him to sit down, I got him a can of beer and said, cool down a little. I said, let me give you a little comment on this. Your dad has written you a letter saying that if you don't touch your hair and straighten yourself up, I am going to disown you. That's the letter you wrote? He said, yes. I said, guess what? I have got a letter from my father who says that if you ever dare to touch your hair, I will disown you. Guys, it's all about hair. Both of us could get disowned if we disagree with our dads. Right? One if you cut your hair, and one if you don't cut your hair. Now, for somebody who understands and recognizes that what is correct or true in one context may not necessarily be true in another context. Right? And that is actually as fundamental as saying that telling the truth is a good idea. It's as fundamental as that. Particularly in the world that all of you are going to experience for many years of your life. Understanding. Now, I'll give you another example of it, which is very common. You've all heard of Brexit?
Yes, sir.
Right? So let me just get a word here. How many of you think that the UK's decision to break away from Europe is a good idea? Put up your hands. Wow. Only three people. I presume the rest think? Oh, okay. How many of you are not really bothered? Wow, that's also a very good number. And how many of you are bothered and say it's a bad idea? Okay, that's the largest thing. Okay, thank you. Well, you have a good representation. Now, look at just within us. On the phenomena called Brexit, we have a view that says it's a good idea. We have a view that says it's not such a good idea. And many of you, with these differential ideas, I guarantee you, in future, will be sitting across tables where you will be holding your positions and discussing implications on your businesses. You've all heard of Tata Steel's operations in the UK? And that operation in the UK also has businesses in Europe. So if you are a company, if you're a company that has only Indian operations, no, you don't sell anywhere else, would you be worried about Brexit? Unlikely. At some margin, this might impact you if there are still some raw materials or something like that coming from some other part of the world. But by and large, you might say, okay, doesn't really bother me. But if you're Mr. Ratan Tata or Mr. what's the Tanik Sherman's name? Mr. Cyrus Mistry? Mr. Cyrus Mistry, if you are then, you think you will be worried? You'll be very worried about these implications. Right? So, depending upon what the circumstances and what the context is, you will have to be aware of all the perspectives that Brexit clears. If you want to be the person that Mr. Cyrus Mistry selects to join his steel team, if you walk up to Mr. Mistry and you express a view that I don't care, or express a view that Brexit is a good idea, I suspect Mr. Mistry will think to himself, and I don't know whether I should pick this guy on my team. On the other hand, if you were to say, Mr. Tata, I can understand that there are some positions and where some places we might be affected adversely, and this could be some of those. On the other hand, there are some good reasons for us to take other parties. On the third side, I think in any case, we should take a very considered view after looking at all the perspectives of the implications on us and our company in this field. Who do you think Mr. Tata would select? Who do you think Mr. Tata would select? The guy who is the last guy who says all this wonderful suggestion implying that he has an ability to understand context and recognizes the importance of understanding context. Okay, I'm about sort of running out of time. Let me spend a few minutes just simply asking you, before I say some concluding comments, asking you, how does the idea of perspectives, how does the importance of context, how does the importance of knowing different lenses and developing an ability, you can put on a pair of dark glasses and the world suddenly looks different, right? You can look through a kaleidoscope and my God, does it change shape, you know, every time you do a little twist to it. So if you all develop and actually work yourselves on an ability to look at the same phenomenon, whether it's a project report, whether it's the development of a product, an idea, if you have an ability to examine it from different perspectives, I can guarantee you that you will have an edge over everything else. And through the TALF initiative, we hope that we will give you some insights. Much of the work has to be done by you guys. But hopefully we will give you some insights that will allow you to develop that competence of having multiple lenses. But most importantly, I would also say, please, each one of you, spend a little time on searching your own heritage. Okay? Whatever excites you. Doesn't matter what. I was interviewing once a young student for the Qatar Administrative Service. And this young student was neither an engineer nor an MBA, which is a problem. That combination is a very powerful one. And he happened to be a literature graduate, English literature graduate. In my opinion, I thought was brilliant. But in the opinion of my colleagues on the interview panel, they thought that he wouldn't be a good fit. So in an attempt to sort of give him another opportunity, I asked him the question, so what is it that really excites you? What are you passionate about? You know, what would you want to spend some time intriguing time on? Well, what he did was to ask you questions about what he was good at, not trying to find out what he's not good at. And you know, he surprisingly said, and you'll be surprised by this one, I certainly was, I didn't know what to do for a moment. For 20 seconds, I was a little sort of, and I thought my colleagues would now completely write him off because of what he said. And he said to me, the sexual habits of spiders. Can you imagine? Interview. And so for a moment we were also quiet. We didn't know how to react to this stuff. But then I engaged with him. I discussed with him. He was simply brilliant. Brilliant is the word. Incidentally, contrary to what my colleague said, I insisted that he was selected. He went on to become managing director of Tata Memorial. So, please be passionate and intense, develop this skill. Develop the skill of multiple lenses. If you have a strong point of view on anything, enable yourselves to take and support and justify and explain the complete contrarian view as well. Do it. You will find that your mental faculties will multiply, the brain will be challenged, and you will come out better, as a better human being as well. So do that. So let me ask you questions. Anything that you want to ask, anything, it doesn't matter, it's got nothing to do with your perspective. But is there anything you want to ask? Go ahead. Wow. No questions. Yes.
I'm from the second year, and I want to ask you one question, sir. Do you think democracy is really suitable for India?
Yeah. Democracy is suitable for India. Wow. Okay, but that's like really in the category of other questions, right? It's not nothing but. But let me give you my view. Absolutely fundamentally important. It's the only country in the world, which incidentally in 60 years. You know how long it took democracy to take root in the United Kingdom, which is considered the mother of democracy? You know how long? About 400 years. You know how long we have taken in this multicultural setting? 60 years. We have taken democracy down to our panchayats. Now, is it perfect? No, it isn't. Do we still have work to do? We still have work to do. But in 60 years, what India has done on democracy is a world record by any standard. Nobody else, no other country. No other country in the world. None. I would like anybody to contest us on that one. Nobody else has been able to actually take democracy to our grassroots. We have still much work to do to make sure that it is fairer and more of this thing. But God, can we be proud of the idea that this country, with all its complexity, with all its difficulty, with all its challenges, with all its diversity, we have taken on democracy like nobody else has. So that's the answer. Any other questions? Yes?
Sir, actually, earlier I didn't know, I was not able to say something about the Islam thing that you said. So why is this religion really misunderstood by everyone?
Why religion?
So why Islam is basically misunderstood people, why don't they think from their point of view about Islam?
Yeah, and I incidentally, if I could answer that well, I would be advisor to about 5 presidents of the world. But let me at least attempt a point of view. I have just finished actually reading a book, which is a 600-page small print magnus opus on, and the title of the book is, some of you might want to read it, it's called The Evolution of God. And obviously, that book touches a lot on the question of faith. And there can hardly be any contrarian view to the comment that faith has had a huge impact on the evolution of human society, right from 10,000 BC to the current period. Faith. It has helped us in ways of creating stability, in inculcating value systems, in doing a lot of good. But it is also to be said that it has also caused some of the most traumatic circumstances in the world. We know that what happened to all of South America, we know what happened to Australia, we know what happened to many parts of the world because of faith, or its, what should I say, its not so good side of faith. So the simple answer is that Islam as a faith today is challenged because of a large number of people who, to my mind, are quite ignorant about faith. And they are seeing or they're creating themselves impressions about the faith through a very, very narrow lens. And all of them, I would urge them to open their lenses and see it from its beauty. And I think the preponderant emphasis becomes that let's look at the beauty of the faith, and that hopefully the situation will change. But it's a challenging situation right now. Is there another one there? Yeah.
Now my question, sir, is you just told us about different perspectives from one. So wouldn't anyone, her, him or her, would get confused even more rather than just taking it to one opinion?
Well, thank you for that comment. Huh? One of the new wonderful phrases that are used for innovation is called disruptive innovation. You would have heard of that? No? But okay. Now, One of the things that we say is that you must disrupt the status quo. So if you are saying that a singular perspective is very comforting, it's true. I agree with that. But the trouble is that a singular perspective is not the world that you will live in. You will not live in that world. You will live in a world where you have to deal with multiple perspectives. Now, if you don't have the ability to deal with multiple perspectives, I suspect that you will be isolated. You will be isolated, and you will find it very difficult to traverse the landscape of the future. So you're right in saying that a singular perspective is comforting. But comfort is not necessarily the reality of your circumstance or the circumstance of the world.
But it would be better to listen to a different perspective from someone else other than being confused on what to convey.
Well, finally, incidentally, so here's how some resolution of that dilemma that you pose. Ultimately, let us say you've got to decide on a product. You are a company executive, you have to decide on the product. What we are urging you is to look at that product from all different perspectives. Okay? And finally, you have to come to a conclusion now. That this is the one I want to go to. So you will come to that. So you will come. But you will be better off in making the right choice about what product if you have looked at it from different perspectives. If you have looked at it only from one perspective, as Mr. McDonald did, they came and suffered a loss. But if they had seen it from different perspectives, maybe they could have earlier on said, right at the beginning we launched with a, had McDonald's launched their entry into India with a vegetarian hamburger, do you think they would have been much more successful? That's the point. So instead of narrow, take all the perspectives, then choose one. So we believe that the one that you will choose will be a better one simply because you put many perspectives into account.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Anybody else before we sort of... Okay, last question then. I think we are probably running against time. Yes, last question.
Yes, in the last few centuries, most of the powerful countries of the world have been majorly Christian. Any reason why?
Most of the powerful countries of the world have been?
Christian.
Majorly Christian. I mean, very sort of. Well, I'm reading another book which is lying in my car right now. I'm very pleased that you're asking questions about stuff that I'm reading these days. But the book incidentally is called Sapiens, S-A-P-I-E-N, Homo Sapiens. It's a wonderful book on, and it does delve on this question of what are the factors that led to the fact that Christianity becomes a very dominant force in the world. And it's again a very, very vast question. Maybe next time when I'm here, you come to me, I will spend half an hour with you in trying to give you some sense of that. But it is true that Christianity takes on the kind of preponderance that it does, multiple set of factors. Most of the European powers that made the world, it became the world's colonial powers, were Christian. Right? Most of them, incidentally, when they went out on expeditions to the rest of the world, they carried many things. One was to do trade, and earn, therefore, resources and income from those countries. But the other was also to say that they wanted to spread Christianity because they believed that was the only faith that we should have. So it was a combination between business, trade, and a belief in faith. And because they became colonial powers, Christianity grew the way it was. It decimated in South America. The Inca Empire, the Mayan Empire were all decimated by the landing of Spanish Christians into that part of the world. That doesn't make incidentally all Christians bad. That just says that history has a subset of time when it was. And then of course at a point in time we had the great invasions of Islam, and the Ottoman Empire, which had a huge impact prior to that. So, you know, there have been times and times in the history of the planet where different people have grown for a variety of reasons. So So that's the subject matter of very large discussion. Okay? Okay, I'm going to sort of end here, and let me end by saying this, spend your 4 years at NU with some intensity. Be intense in whatever you do. I presume that in that whatever bucket, engineering subjects will also be part of that bucket. Otherwise, Mr. Rao and some of our other senior colleagues might be a little challenged in that bucket, engineering is not there. So be intense. I can tell you one other thing. A lot of what you will learn is actually outside the classroom. Right? So if that be true, then remember that whatever you're doing outside the classroom should be as intense as whatever it is that you're doing inside the classroom. And I have a new EA who happens to be in Gloucester. So, Amit, you want to work your hands? Amit is my new EA. I travel a lot, and I'm not in office, and we have a small office out of which I work. And I told him that part of your experience, and I'm saying this to you, some of you will become executive assistants to the chairman and the like before you take on and become chairman yourself. I said to him that it's not so much of what you learn and gain when you are sort of in a structured classroom, in a structured setting. Many of you will have oftentimes time at your hands. The differentiating individual is one who adds value to him or herself when they have nothing to do. What do you do with your spare time? Now, if you are intense in your spare time, whatever, incidentally, if you sleep well, and you know, dream well, about it. So, whatever it is that you do, please be intense. I think that, really speaking, is extremely important that you should be intense. The second big message, if I may say, is please have open mind. Your brain, for the most intense people, the likes of Mr. Einstein, incidentally, now is known that they do not even spend more than about 9% of their brain capacity. So don't worry about your brain. It can take a lot. Do everything possible, including in your spare time, to have a very open mind. Open mind. The famous Rabindranath Tagore prayer, which he said, let my land be all the doors, and Gandhi said, all my doors should be open for the winds to flow through of every kind of perspective and point of view. Let it flow through. So open mind, be intense, be open. And last I would suggest is, that, and I again think that this is something for the future, is remain curious. Remain curious. I think it will hold you in good stead. How many of you, incidentally, put up your hand, how many of you would love to spend time with, let's say, your 6 and 7 or 8 years old, either sisters or brothers or nieces or nephews? How many of you would like to spend time with them? Wow, fantastic. Is this an honest comment? Okay, that's terrific. Why is it that you want to spend time with them?
Because they're cute. Because they're cute.
They are cute and they ask some silly questions sometimes.
Yes. Yeah.
And they're curious. So, retain that curiosity through your years of tenure. If any faculty member does you down, and this is with the permission, I hope that I'm not overstepping myself. But if any faculty member says, shut up, you know, you don't need to talk about this, don't stop. Now, remain curious. So, be intense, be open, remain curious, and I hope that you're very, very successful in whatever you do in your future years, and you have a really enjoyable stay at NU. Thank you very much.